Welcome to all of our attendees. Welcome this morning. So wonderful to have you with us today. We're just going to give everyone a moment to get on. Folks are trickling in. I see you trickling in. Thank you so much for being here with us today. We are excited to share with you this really wonderful, beautiful story of transmigration. So we'll get started in just a minute. Once again, thank you so much for being with us today. We have a really wonderful group of incredible voices who are gathered today to share with you a really beautiful, heartbreaking, special story. And we want to get started because there's much to share. All right. I'm going to pause every now and then because I'm taking the questions as I see them come in, or I'm checking out the questions. All right. Well, thank you. We today will be talking about the migration from Puerto Rico to Hawaii and how some of those folks who journeyed out at the turn of the last century made their way back. And while this history is very robust, it is it has a lot of moving pieces. Today, we're going to take a high-level approach to that history, and then we're going to really narrow in and focus on the cultural impact made by these Puerto Ricanos, these Boricuas. The name of the show is Adios Boricua, Aloha Borinkee, from Puerto Rico to Hawaii and back. And it is, in a sense, a retrospective of a 2006 show that was part of a requirement for a doctoral program that I was in at Northwestern University. All first-year students had to put together a recital. And while the focus of my research for that degree at the time that I was working on is what I do in Bomba, what I study, how I document, and the lens that I'm using to look at that traditional practice, I thought I would use the recital as an opportunity to give a voice to this other area of research for me. And so you'll see, you've seen through some of the promotion, scenes from that show, photographs or video. There is a lot to share, but there are other folks who have also done some research that is significant and have put forth their research in this world that I wanted you to hear those voices as well. Today we also, in addition to those researchers and cultural movers, these cultural significant cultural contributors, we also have descendants of that migration. It's important to know that we're using the word migration because at the time they left Puerto Rico, they were a part of the United States. And that relationship was changing at the beginning of that relationship. So they weren't immigrants in the same way that many others were. The experience was almost identical to an immigrant experience, but there was this unique level of relationship to the United States that was really complicated. And you'll hear a little bit more about it as we keep moving through the show. Today, I just like to, let's see. Please bear with me as I advance. Let's figure out how to advance my slides here. Yes, I would like to give a thank you to all of you. I'd like to start with a thank you to all of you because we're here today. I'm a very big proponent of grassroots education, grassroots cultural organizing, and anybody who has been a part of my work in the past, you know that even though my day job is as a grant writer and all I've ever done is work in the nonprofit sector, I actually really firmly believe in community organizing and working together to bring forth a purpose and to have that experience together in community. So I'd like to thank all of you who are here today and donated to be here to support this work and the folks who are sharing of themselves today and their work. I'd also like to thank Alianza Center for coming on as an event sponsor, again, to help us with this panel, and then the folks who are participating as with promotional support, Puerto Ricans in Action, ASHE, also the Shirley Hall Dance Educators Forum, which works with ASHE, the Sociedad Puertorriqueña de Genealogía, and Bomba Marile. And now, I'd like to really get into the subject here. There's so much to say, and this is a very complicated story, as I mentioned. But this started, this particular show, Adios Boricua, Aloha Borinkee, started as a recital, as I mentioned, and I'm chairing a bit of the script for that show, which thankfully my director, Cristin Carole here on the panel, still had in her possession. And as we go through, I'm going to introduce each panelist as we get to their section. We have seven folks here today who were here to share their story. You've read some their bios in anticipation of the event, which have been shared. But these are people doing incredible work, have an incredible story, and are really important to this process of telling the story today. So the 2006 show, it came together and pulled together all of these disparate pieces of history to stage a kind of a really unknown or a little known part of Puerto Rican history. As a recital that was part of a degree requirement, it was meant to be a one-woman show. And that was the actual assignment, the task set before me. But that honestly is so antithetical to how I work. And I'm always much more inspired to tell a story, to do a work, to do anything that it will impact the community, to do it with the community. And so I asked as many of my friends and family members as I could to be part of ensemble moments in the show. And you'll see and hear a little bit more about that. Just moving along here, again, high level history, and we'll drill down into a little bit of these details with each individual panelist. I'm sure many of you have had a chance to look at this history related to this relationship and kind of how this got going. In 1898 is a very important year for Puerto Rico's relationship to the United States. And I will let you look into that a little bit more, but basically there was a transition of power in terms of Puerto Rico's colonial relationship. And that shifted from Spain to the United States based on a whole set of circumstances tied to the Spanish-American War. So please take some time on your own if you don't already know about that history to look at that and all of the problematic ways that it continued to affect and shape or continues to affect and shape the colonial relationship between Puerto Rico and the U.S. In 1899, another kind of a natural phenomena also kind of rocked the island and changed some of the dynamics there that were economic. We all have this fresh reference of Hurricane Maria and how Hurricane Maria devastated the island, devastated coffee crops, devastated the economy, and we're in a modern era. So just imagine what that devastation was like more than 100 years ago. People were desperate and they were looking for ways to feed their families, to support support themselves, to not starve. And here we have the U.S. coming in and looking for opportunities to stimulate their own economic growth through this newly acquired territory. And so we have also Hawaii's in a bit of a similar situation in terms relationally with the US. And so you have these business strategists, these capitalists who go into Hawaii, they're setting up corporations, setting up their own businesses. And then when Puerto Rico comes into the mix and they see an opportunity to either duplicate or utilize some of the natural resources available in Puerto Rico, especially vulnerable because of this hurricane, they come in and basically offer folks the opportunity to go work in Hawaii using skills that these agricultural workers really only had available to them. They were the ones most affected by the hurricane and didn't have any land to work. And so they were offered these contracts, these which basically were contracts of indentured servitude, to leave Puerto Rico, aboard a steamship, get over to Hawaii, and then work there for a period, a defined period of time. And you'll hear about how that played out as we continue moving. And so that first group set out. And you can see kind of this trickle, this domino effect of circumstances, 1898, 1899. And then here we are in 1900, people are hungry. They are without work, without resources. They're under new colonial rule. There's a lot of confusion. They're desperate and looking for a way to sustain themselves. And so in November of 1900, a group of families, individuals and families, set out on a steamship and made their way to New Orleans. And here is where the show starts. The show starts with a hurricane, there's a prologue, and there's kind of this preamble of the dance you may have seen in anticipation of the show, where Cristin Carole, who was the director, she's also a modern ballerina, and she interpreted Hurricane San Siriaco and the devastation that it caused in the island. So the very next scene takes us to folks coming off the ship and bringing with them their possessions. And if you have ever studied any cultural group, you know that, and migration patterns and migration histories, you know that they take what is most important to them. They take the things that represent themselves, their culture. Why? So that they can continue to propagate that culture, those practices, those traditions, wherever it is that they end up. And so in New Orleans, we see kind of the first really important cultural footprint. And that inspired that first, it's really the anchor scene of the show where we see passengers kind of getting off the ship and bringing with them a contribution that they give to Louisiana. And there, the scene is, it shows all of these passengers kind of having an interaction with the folks who themselves were sharecroppers in Louisiana and having this exchange. And so what they gave, what they contributed was sweet potato and other, I would really say other, it's not the only thing that they brought, but it was what was familiar, it was palatable, it was recognizable to the Louisiana agricultural industry. So when they saw that one food item, they knew what it was. And it was a variety that was unique and they had not been able, or they did not have circulating. And so this whole history related to yams in Louisiana, and in the United States, if you've ever heard anybody refer to a sweet potato as a yam, it is because of this influx of Puerto Ricans who brought their foods. And you can see from the image on the upper right part of the screen, an example of a ñame, what we call ñame in Puerto Rico, which is the yam, and then on the left here, the sweet potato. And so this image was in the show, it was in the scene, that anchored scene. I and several of the other passengers, we gave sweet potatoes to one of the sharecroppers. And so let me just, I posted one of those images, this one, in anticipation of the show. You can see the crate label, and I'm setting this up because I really want our next guest, he's done his own research, but I want you to see how the crate labels were used in the show. This is our friend Kai, and I say our because Chris and I, we go way back to undergrad. Kai was, we were all in undergrad together. Kai is an amazing performer, singer, and so she sang during the scene. And so you can hear, you can see the people kind of, once they got off the ship, they're going across the stage, and at her feet, you can't really see it too well, it's poor video quality from 14 years ago. And these are stills from that video, but they're depositing sweet potatoes into the crate that has this cool label right on it. And so you'll see a lot of other racist imagery. I'm not gonna talk about that actually, because I think it's a really wonderful segue to our next speaker. But here you'll see koalas, yams. You have another character I'll introduce a little bit later. And here, down here with king yams as well. So with that, I leave you in the very capable and knowledgeable hands of our next speaker, a really wonderful, important artist of our time, New York-based Boricua artist, Puerto Rican artist, New Rican artist, Miguel Luciano. I think you're on mute.
Okay, hello everybody. Can you see this on screen? Am I sharing the right screen? Okay, great. Thanks, Melanie. Thanks for having me. So I'm so excited to hear from everybody else too about this kind of extended history and story. So thanks again for inviting me to be part of this. My sort of a relationship to this work in history, it has to do with those labels that you just referred to. And so I'm showing on screen here sort of like this map from the Puerto Rico steamship company, or that was one of the early steamship companies that brought people to New Orleans and to New York eventually as well. But that migration to New Orleans was the first port of entry for Puerto Ricans, really the first significant labor program that I'm aware of, that is bringing Puerto Ricans to Hawaii to work in the sugar industry and the sugar plantations in Hawaii. And so the first port of entry was New Orleans. And so it's also part of a larger narrative that I'm sure we'll get into about sugar corporations in California that begin to recruit Puerto Ricans as a kind of as a new labor pool that was readily exploitable, really, at that time. And that was sort of their motivation. So I'm going to show some of these images here and just give you a sense of some of these labels. So these labels come out in the 30s, really. Like the 30s and 40s are when this yam variety is popularized in Louisiana. And and so the migration begins in 1900, 1901. And so this is some years later. So it's fascinating thinking about those who migrated bringing yams with them, because they eventually were imported and then also sort of instituted as the most popular yam variety in Louisiana at the time. So by the 30s, they become just that. They become like the most popular yam variety. And it's a sweet potato that's also called a yam, but it is the sort of like the soft, fleshy, sweet potato that we think of when we think about yams, sweet potatoes. And the first images then of Puerto Rican branded products, consumer products in the U.S. appear on these labels that I'm aware of anyways. And the images were often very racist kinds of depictions of Puerto Ricans that were really the same kinds of racist caricatures and stereotypes of African-Americans in the South at that time that were equally applied to Puerto Ricans. And so these are just a few examples of some of those labels. And so, you know, the way I became aware of these is that I was in grad school at the time. My mom was on a project at a conference in New Orleans, and she found some of these postcards in a tour shop in New Orleans, and they were all these Puerto Rican branded yams and sweet potatoes, some that were incredibly offensive, like this one. This is like the most racist and most explicitly racist label among these groups, that were repackaged and sold as postcards as kind of Southern memorabilia. She sent me a whole package. I was in Puerto Rico at the time, these were unfamiliar sort of like references to me. I didn't know about this history, this migration. I started doing research at that time. And I also then started to, I was doing research in Puerto Rico and then later at Center for Puerto Rican Studies in New York, and sort of piecing together this migration history. But I've been very fascinated with the visual history, right? And thinking about how these kinds of stereotypes proliferated in consumer products for a very long time, really from the beginning of our relationship with the US, and sort of looking at how racism also was so much a part and has been so much a part of our experience with the US in our colonial history. So I started then I wanted to make new paintings based on these crate labels that had become postcards and that were still in distribution. And so my paintings were these kind of responses to these colonial histories. They started like in 2000, late 99, 2000 is when I was making these paintings. And so Coon brand Puerto Rican sweet potatoes became Coño brand Puerto Rican sweet potatoes. And the sweet potato transforming into the island of Vieques, which was very much sort of in the midst of the struggle to get the Navy to leave Vieques, and another example of our colonial kind of relationship with the US. And I'll show a few details of these paintings. So I was looking at how to transform these kind of racist stereotypes and this racist imagery into images and stories of resistance. So how do we reclaim these histories and transform them in ways that speak back to this history from a place of resistance? This is another example. Oh Mama, Louisiana brand Puerto Rican sweet potatoes, became this painting titled Oh Mama. And so here, the sort of three figures that were there in the background come to represent the different political parties in Puerto Rico in terms of statehood, the Commonwealth, and independence. And there are all these kinds of layered narratives about Puerto Rican history and politics that enter in. And then in thinking about mother and the idea of mother as culture and as history, I thought about the images of the Virgin Mary that are so popular in Puerto Rican sort of art history, and really sort of challenging this idea of how we see ourselves and our own history and heritage, right, through this colonial lens, even on the island. So the white sort of Catholic version of the Virgin Mary, for example, versus La Virgen de Monserrate, and this is a very famous print image from Lorenzo Omar about the tradition of carved wooden saints in Puerto Rico that depicts the Black Madonna. And so in the history of carved wooden saints in Puerto Rico, La Virgen de Monserrate was one of the most popular versions of carved wooden saints because she looked like the people and people gravitated towards her. And so again, sort of challenging viewers to think about the way that we even see ourselves and our own culture and history through this colonial lens. And then throughout all these paintings are these other kinds of texts and narratives that look at sort of consumerism and consumer culture as another colonial kind of phenomenon, and sort of remixing these different stories of colonialism and resistance, right? Borrowing from children's books and coloring books and other kinds of stories about our history that tell lesser known stories of rebellions and resistance against Spanish colonial rule and enslavement, for example. And then looking at also contemporary forms of colonial conditioning. Aunt Lodi's yams became, these are the original labels that became this painting called Lodi Knows. And again, sort of evoking the image of the Madonna here, who has taken the head of Ronald McDonald's in her canasta in the basket here. And so it's also sort of looking at sort of consumerism as a kind of religion in and of itself, which has been another critique in a lot of my work for a long time. Uncle Cola's yams here became this painting, Uncle Cola. And here again, challenging this idea of servitude and these images that are really sort of derived from slavery and indentured servitude, and turning them into these kinds of figures that embody a kind of resistance. And so his platter here sort of transforms from the yams into this other kind of platter, yams and a happy meal, or a not so happy meal maybe, with these French fries that turns into machetes and things like this. So evoking again, like the symbols of resistance. Bunny Brand, this is actually one of the paintings that's behind me in the studio, became Barceloneta Bunnies, and sort of thinking here about the history of sterilization programs on the island and how the US government sort of made sterilization an official policy in the 30s. So around the same time these labels are happening, you have a US appointed governor like Blanton Winship endorsing sterilization programs through eugenics as a belief system and openly sort of endorsing it as a program, as a eugenics program to curb the population growth on the island. And so Barceloneta was one of those towns that was famous for having introduced aggressive sterilization programs. And it ironically, you know, later became the seat of the pharmaceutical industry. And so part of the things that are happening in this painting with all of these different bunnies is that it mixes these histories of sterilization programs with the Pfizer company and the sort of artificial virility drugs. And so the town that was known for sterilization so vividly in the documentary La Operación, which is a great documentary about this history, you can find it on YouTube now, The Operation. That same town is, you know, became the seat of production for Viagra. Like 80% of the world's Viagra at some point was made in this one factory in this one town in Puerto Rico. And so those kind of histories on top of one another for me were just strange and ironic. And these bunnies were very sort of confused, you know, like the tricks rabbit here taking his own foot to have a lucky rabbit's foot, right? In search of this kind of prize that was always a dubious prize, whether that prize was about modernity or the promise of modernity or statehood or any of these other sort of like ideas that seek power outside of ourselves. And here more recently, this is a Victory Brand. This would have been like, you know, after the war, that this label, I'm assuming when this was made, so somewhere in the 40s probably, and that turns into Vulture Brand yams. And so this is a more recent series. I started these in 2000. I added this painting a couple of years ago, looking at the contemporary crisis, the debt crisis on the island, right? And so this, the victory turns into the vulture, Wall Street and hedge funds sort of preying upon Puerto Rico's debt. That's what this two-headed sort of eagle vulture sort of comes to represent. My timer there. Here the yams sort of transform into the Taino Trigonolito, which is, you know, a very famous image, the three-pointed stone depicts a semi in the rock, right? And we are all familiar with that in Puerto Rico. And that shape is actually related to the yam or the sweet potato. And so that was part of the symbolism within that carving. And so here, that transformation sort of then evokes another kind of power or resistance towards even the current crisis. And there's all kinds of things that I don't have time to get into, but you can check out on the website, but details in these paintings, remixing of the text in the original labels too. This was, in the new painting is packed by No a la Junta, right? And so No a la Junta is also one of the rallying cries to say no against the fiscal board. And it's a protest of the fiscal board in Puerto Rico. The last painting that I want to show here is actually not part of this series, but it felt kind of appropriate in this context. And I had forgotten about this originally, but this was actually a small painting I did for Calle 13 and Residente years ago when he did a song called Multiviral and invited a series of artists to do something about how we reinterpret this idea of multiviral, something that goes multiviral, right? I mean, that sounds like a whole different thing today in this context of COVID, but thinking about the phenomenon of information, of the power of information to go viral, and us potentially being in control of that information or that power. I think that was the essence. And here I was thinking about the kachi as this symbol that travels from Puerto Rico sort of inadvertently to Hawaii, and how it then connects our two island histories once again, except that kachi is so beloved as a symbol in Puerto Rico and revered and romanticized, but it becomes a public nuisance in Hawaii. And I thought that was such a kind of sad irony, but again, trying to sort of kind of flip this back and think about the kachi and its perseverance, right? And how it survives with us and our history and our culture, despite, you know, the challenges of our migration and these kind of overlapping colonial histories. So I think I'll leave it there. And I look forward to the rest of the discussion. Thanks so much, Melanie.
Yes, of course. That was wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that history. And as everybody can hear, what started as a marketing ploy to introduce a new variety of sweet potato by drawing on the Puerto Rican word for another completely different crop item, a food item, the ñame, you get yam. And so here you can see the cultural footprint in Louisiana, in New Orleans, by these Puerto Ricans is gastronomical. It's food related, it's food ways. And as we think about culture in terms of practices, you're going to hear throughout this presentation some of the many different ways in which Puerto Ricans left a cultural footprint throughout the United States, the Hawaiian Islands, and then back in Puerto Rico. And I'm so glad, we didn't get to that one. Thank you so much, Miguel, and here you are. Miguel, as you could see, everyone, when I really say we're kind of doing a high level history, in order to be able to kind of thread all of these pieces together, we're really glossing over, I know I am, a lot of the history so that we can just introduce it and then and kind of trigger your interest so that you can go learn more on your own. You can see that each piece of this, each speaker can certainly give their own presentation. There's so much content here. There's so much history. There's so much knowledge that we can share that's yet to be known, and look at how beautifully it's manifesting even in contemporary culture and inspiring. So thank you, Megan. The kachi was actually such an important figure in the show, and the kachi actually opened and closed the show, again, as this unwitting migrant to Puerto Rico. At least in I did a voiceover throughout the show. And in that initial voiceover, one of the things that I said was kind of in Puerto Rico, everything that I've ever heard was that if you ever take the kachi out of Puerto Rico, it won't survive. And so it became kind of a metaphor for these Boricuas and that test, could they survive? Could their culture survive? And so today's presentation is how their culture, how our culture did survive and has survived and impacted so many others. So we're leaving New Orleans now. We're leaving New Orleans. These Boricuas are loaded up on trains. They're taken across the southern United States at night, in large part so that the trip, the purpose wouldn't be questioned. People died along the way. They were left at train depots at night. So these dead bodies were left at train depots at night so that the purpose wouldn't be questioned. Why there were these people, the hungry folks were hungry, they were mistreated through the strip. And by the time they get to the West Coast, they are so exasperated, so crushed, their spirits are crushed. They're frightened, they're scared that about half of those that originally set out on this trip. And you saw at the beginning, the one number says 114. I've seen other numbers. I use the 114 number because it kind of closely matched this newspaper article. But you see, they set out in November. Here in December, by the they set out in mid-November. By the time they get to the West Coast, they are terrified of what they have already experienced and how that might be their life, their future moving forward. And so you can see, here's a newspaper article, or the front page of the Examiner from December 15th, 1900. And so here I popped out this little section here that says, threats and force put 66 Puerto Ricans on Rio, which is Rio de Janeiro. That was the name of the ship. But 50 others, so half of their of that group of people escaped and disappeared into the local fabric of California. I'm hoping one of our panelists later might mention something about that. They were terrified. They imagine in 1 month, whatever it is that they experienced in that 1 month, it motivated them to make the unconscionable decision to just disappear into a place they had never even been to, which was that local community there in San Francisco. I want you to just pay attention to the date again, 1900, because that's gonna, we're gonna come back to that in a second. And these people right here, these are Puerto Ricanos being loaded up under threat and by force onto the ship Rio. Here is a 1910 census. I'm also a genealogist, so I spent a lot of time in the archive looking at records, studying them, looking for detail, clues that will tell me something about individuals, people, families that I'm looking at. And I hope you can see this photograph here. I'm gonna pop so that I can make sure I can see it. So here in the 1910 census, we see a family, and here's that family. This is the Caraballo family. Well, he's Caraballo. But as you know, anytime you kind of step foot in the States, women get subsumed under the patriarchal structure of the United States, and that genealogical identity is gone. I love that as a genealogist, that in Puerto Rico, people use both names, maternal and paternal. It helps me understand who they are and from whom they come. So here though, we have Jose Caraballo and his wife Claudina. What I wanted you to see, and let's see if it'll let me zoom in. One of the things about the 1910 census is that it asks when you immigrated to the United States. And so here we have 1900 for Jose, 1900 for his wife, and then 1900 for his next three children. And then the next four children were born in Hawaii. So that becomes important for introducing our next speaker, who is Heather Paulino. Heather, can you, hi Heather. Heather is in Hawaii, everyone. It is 8:41 a.m. and she is on the call with us from Hawaii. So we're so thankful to have you.
Hi Kevin.
Heather, can you just tell us your relationship to this document and to the photograph on this document?
Sure. Okay, so I think I said I was fifth generation, but I might be fourth generation because let me tell you how I found this photo. We have in Waipahu, on the kind of the west, central west part of Oahu, there's a museum. It's the Plantation Houses Museum. And so we had different people who came from different places to work in the plantations, in the sugar plantations. And so the museum has houses that represent the different cultures. And one of the cultures obviously is Puerto Rico. And so we're going through the house one day, I was with my mom and my family, and my mom looks at the portrait on the dresser that they have there. And she said, that's my great grandfather. And so I was like, what? And so that got me interested in doing genealogy. So I'm not an expert of any sort compared to the rest of the panelists, but I do know some things about my family. There's a whole few here and there, but yeah, so that is my great-great-grandfather, Jose, and then great-great-grandmother. And I believe the boy in front of him is my great-grandfather's brother. So I think my great-grandfather was the oldest one, Eduardo, and that's his brother, Eugenio, I think, and then a cousin. So yeah, that's...
So, Heather, let's go back for a second, because I think it's so important for people to see... If only 66 people are reported as having gotten onto the ship, and your family self-identifies as having migrated under the column of immigration in 1900, not mm-hmm. only were they part of this first crew, but it's very possible that one of them is even in this photograph. And hey. that's pretty special. Yes, I mean, we kind yeah. of, that's my job. I piece together these little clues so that we can understand. And I think, you're kind of like the four and a half generation now, yeah. right? Because your great-grandfather went as a child, Eduardo. And right. so that generation, when folks come as children, they're usually considered the one and a half generation. Heather, something that we've discussed over the phone a couple of times are some of those cultural influences. That's what we're listening to mm-hmm. today. That's what we're talking about today. Mm-hmm. What are some of those memories, some of those remnants of Puerto Rican culture that have kind of sustained in your family over the generations?
So it's what we would used to call ganduri rice, which is arroz con gandules. Ganduli rice, and then we call them pateles. And even on the side of the road, they'd sell pateles. But then I think I mentioned to you in the past, we never knew there was an S in the middle. We call them pateles. And on the side of the road, they'd have signs that say pateles for sale. Now you can see them spelled the correct way, pateles. But yeah, pateles, arroz con gandules, ganduri rice. I don't know why we'd call it that. Music, my great-grandfather actually, I don't know if I mentioned this to you, he played a lot in bands, like with different Puerto Ricans, and they would be hired and they would play, I guess, what would be called kachi music, which you're going to talk about, I think. Those things, little words, I always tell, I'm a Spanish teacher now, high school Spanish teacher, and I always tell my students, you know, growing up in Hawaii, when I was little, I would always think these words my grandma was using were Hawaiian. And it wasn't until I got a little older that I could start to kind of distinguish, oh, wait, those are Spanish words. And then, you know, because we throw in some pidgin English, we throw in some Hawaiian with, you know, everyday speech. And then it wasn't until a little later that I realized that there were Spanish words that she was using, some of them. So that's some of the stuff.
So I just to go over, I'm all about repetition. we've got, mm-hmm. You mentioned ganduli rice, right? So we have that sound of in Spanish, which is the I in Spanish, but in English, it's kind of the hard or long E, ganduli. We've got...
call it ganduri. Like a
ganduri also. And so there's kind of that linguistic... change of L to D. Yeah. Sometimes in Spanish it's L to R, right? And the R sounds like D yeah. as it keeps evolving. I can't even say it. So my brain wants pateles. To say pasteles. Can you say it again?
Pateles.
Yeah. And then kachi, which we're going to hear about in a little bit. And so tell me, you mentioned your grandmother said some things over the years as you were growing up. The title of this panel today is Adios Boricua, and it's purposefully titled like that because most of the folks that went to Hawaii were from the interior. They were coffee plantation workers, and it's just from the history, people on the island, you know, there really wasn't the sense of Puerto Ricanidad until the 1800s. You were either Español or Criollo, meaning you were from Spain or you were born on the island. A lot of revolutionary activity, including the Grito de Lares, but not exclusively, because there were a lot of revolts by enslaved people that were ill-documented and kind of silenced in that colonial narrative and whitewashing of history. But there was this developing sense of we are from here. And here that was used was Borinquen. And if you were from Borinquen, the Taino word was, I am Boricua. The people from Borinquen were Boricua. And so the name of the show is Aloha Boricua, because when they got to Hawaii and they asked, you, who are you? What are you people in this kind of, this place where Japanese, Korean, Chinese, Portuguese people were mixing, they self-identified not as Puerto Riqueño, but as Boricua. And when that was heard, it was misinterpreted as Borinquen. And Borinquen then became a disparaging term. What can you tell us about growing up hearing that term Borinquen?
So, I mean, within the family, it wasn't, you know, it was used a lot. Like that cousin had really curly hair and he has Borinquen hair. You know, we had a lot of words for all different kinds of different cultures of people. I'm also, my great grandmother on the other side was Portuguese, so it's Portuguese, it's not Portuguese, it's Portuguese, Borinquen. So my grandma was Portuguese, Borinquen is what, that was her ethnic background, so that's what they would say. I think Borinquen food, Borinquen music, that's what they would call it, you know. It wasn't Puerto Rican music. That word, talking about Borinquen, was used instead of Puerto Rican. Mm-hmm. And then I, even talking about how things were changed, I don't know if I'm getting ahead. The last name, when my ancestors came, was Caraballo. Carabello in Spanish, Caraballo. But then it somehow got changed to Caravalho with a Portuguese spelling, V-A-L-H-O. And then the knot was dropped because we do have a lot of Portuguese here, and then it's just Carvalho. So all my cousins, my grandmother's last name on the birth certificate and everything is Carvalho, and that changed from Caravalho. So I was surprised because we thought, wait, Carvalho is Portuguese, but our great-grandfather is Puerto Rican. Like, how did that happen?
So. And I appreciate you bringing that up because as somebody who has studied hundreds of families in Puerto Rico, I see that so much, how a name starts in one kind of language or one version of a name that it just evolves. I think there was one name, Gaudí now, and I'm just pronouncing it phonetically. It's a French name. I found, I think, 11 variations of that name in the records. Mm-hmm. And it was Hispanicized to the extreme of Godinez with a Z, Godinez, Godinet, Godine, Gaudinau, many different spellings and pronunciations. So I appreciate you bringing that up because that happens so much in families. Yeah. Where Caraballo, in your case, Caraballo from Jauco, your family's from Jauco, and I've been able to find them in the records. Their name kind of switched to Portuguese sounding and continue to evolve. And what, how, when would you say that you kind of figured out it was Caraballo?
When I was trying to do genealogy.
Last 10, 20 years?
Wait. Caraballo, what is this? And it's when we go to the different grave sites, there are different spellings.
Yes.
So my great grandfather, Jose, he has Caraballo, or he has Caraballo, but then his wife has Carvalho, and they're like, they're not next to each other, but they're near. I don't know how, like, there's another story. We ended up in the, our family ended up in the Portuguese camp. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that was based on the misspelling of the word. I don't know, I mean, of the name. That's just a story that I've heard, that he ended up in the Portuguese camp. And then that's how I met my grandmother, my great grandmother. And then, so just, or I don't know if they said, hey, it's better to be in the Portuguese camp, so just pretend you're Portuguese. I don't know how, I don't know what happened. So there's all these little things, you know, we speculate and say, why? Why did this happen? And what, you know?
Well, I'm just going to flash back because I love like clues, context clues, right, teachers? My context clues. So north, and then Heather, if you could just help us with this pronunciation before we move on. K-O-H-A-L-A. Kohala?
Kohala.
Kohala? Okay.
Kohala, yeah, Kohala.
All right,
yeah.
That becomes useful for moving on to our next family. Thank you so much, Heather. I appreciate that. Yeah, so we've got Borinkee hair, Borinkee music, kachi kachi, ganduli. You've shown us kind of a linguistic change even in your own family, Caraballo to Carvalho. And so in terms of the cultural contribution in Hawaii, we have music that's kind of grouped together under the banner term of kachi kachi, and we'll talk about this a little bit more. I'll bring this up in a little bit. But Borinkee is a term that has become kind of part of the vocabulary over the last 100 years. And Heather's introduced us to that. All right, I wanna move on and show you a document belonging to another family, also in Kohala. This is a record of marriages in Hawaii from 1902. And right here at the bottom of the screen, the very last two names are Antonio Camacho and Locoria Ramos. I actually zoomed that out so that you could see that right at the bottom. So just from working on this family tree a little bit, I found that they were probably already together, but just legally got married. And that is very common in Puerto Rico, that families, because of mass poverty, because of lack of transportation, couples were just together. They cohabitated, they were common law marriage was very common. And legal marriage was less common. It required under Spanish colonial rule, under a Catholic rule, it required a whole list of requirements that were financial and were about being engaged in a process that if you didn't have transportation and you lived up a mountain, you know, it was difficult for you to participate. So most families were in a common law situation. I believe they were as well. Here you'll see he's listed, it's cut off a little bit as 41. They don't list her age. They're both listed as being Puerto Rican. And as one of our panelists mentioned, I think here, I might be getting confused with our pre-session. The U.S. legally changed the name of our island from Puerto Rico to Puerto Rico. And if you think about how you say the word today, you probably still say Puerto Rican, Puerto Rico, instead of Puerto Rico or Puerto Rican. And that is a remnant of this change. They changed it back. And so that's why we know the name today as Puerto Rico. But they lived in Kohala and they got married July 1st, 1902. Now, the granddaughter of this couple became Hawaii's most renowned researcher, kind of a community researcher, a descendant herself of this migration. And so you can see this early marriage and you'll hear a bit more about her shortly. Her name was Blase Camacho Ramos. All right, just moving right along. So as we're talking about moving from Puerto Rico to New Orleans, to the West Coast to get shipped off, in the first year and a half or so, about 5,000 Puerto Riqueño, 5,000 Boricuas made their way to the Hawaiian Islands. There was that group that escaped in San Francisco. There was a group that lots of folks went to the Hawaiian Islands, they got married. They were already married or coupled, and they began having children. It became difficult once their contract of indentured servitude was expired. It became difficult for them to then go back to the island. So they stayed in the Hawaiian Islands. They stayed, or they tried to make their way back and made it as far back as the West Coast. Let's move on. I want to show you a sibling of Locoria Ramos Borrero. And here her sibling is about halfway down the page. These documents are old. Sometimes they're less legible than others. This one's a little kind of faded, but on line 38, excuse me, we see Domingo Perez, his wife Dominga, who is actually Ramos Borrero, but here again, she's kind of gets subsumed under the patriarchal naming, and she's Perez. But, and I know she's Perez because I know the family story a bit, but here we already see what we saw with Heather's family, where Caraballo became Carvalho or Carvalho. Here, Perez becomes Perry. It's easier to pronounce. And so Domingo Perry and his family. And you can see that I popped their little section out here. Domingo is the head. Dominga Perry is the wife. So with that, I would like to transition to, I'm going to show you one more document with the same family, and then I will introduce you to one of their descendants. So the same family made their way, they went to Hawaii, they were there, you can see the Locoria got married in 1902, so they were part of that first 5,000 group of people, and this migration continued through the mid-20s. But they were there in 1902. Locoria got married in 1902. Her sister and family are in the 1910 census. And then in the 1930 census in San Francisco, we see the same family. This is the one that I believe is at 24. This one's even more faded, and they tried to pop it out. But now the name becomes Perry, P-E. The other one was written as P-E-R-I. Here the name is P-E-R-R-Y, Perry. And again, we have Domingo. His wife's name was Juana Dominga. She's Dominga Perry in the 1910 census. In 1930 in San Francisco, Juana Dominga becomes Jenny Perry. So she left Puerto Rico as Juana Dominga Ramos Borrero. Within 30 years, she is now Jenny Perry. And so we see this is the erasure that happens in the documents. This is the erasure that happens with forced migration or emigration when economic circumstances or other kinds of persecution force a group of people to move. But I'd like to introduce you to one of the descendants of this Perez family, the Perry family. With us today, we have John Santos. John, can you tell us about your family, your connection, and their experiences?
Yes, Melanie, thank you so much. What an honor to be part of this. There's so much to say and so little time to do it, so I'm gonna just jump right in. One thing I want to mention is that I think it's important, there's a historical thing that happened in 1897. We always talk about 1898 when the U.S. invaded, but I think it's important because this historical event got swept under the rug, but it was very present in the minds of our descendants who were there at the time. That's the fact that Puerto Rico had signed the Carta Autonomica with Spain in 1897, so they had been granted already their autonomy. So when Spain handed Puerto Rico over to the United States in 1898, that relationship from the get was illegal. And that's what's put into motion our whole colonial relationship with this country. But it's something that most Puerto Ricans even are not aware that it existed, because it doesn't exist in our history books here in the States. I have basically some family history I want to share, and some photos and a little bit of music, and basically to illustrate how culture and music is this very important thread in the maintenance of identity for these Boricuas. So I want to share my screen, and hopefully this will work. Can you see my screen? Yeah, good. Okay, so I'm gonna start by just putting a little bit of music on. I'm introducing you here to Domingo Perry, who you've been talking about, Domingo Perez, the patriarch of our family, who's the one who left Puerto Rico with his wife. And I'm gonna play for you some music that would be music that they loved, music that he especially related to, because he was a person who helped a lot in the labor, in the hiring of Puerto Ricanos in San Francisco once he got here. And, my mom was telling me that he, unlike most of the Puerto Ricans, he was not a religious person. He really did not like what the church represented because of the colonial history and people, having all their faith in the church, but not being able to respond to the needs of the community in terms of work and what have you. So I'm going to play this piece from 1930. They got here in 1925, but it's a complex story. Anyway, I'm going to put this on as a background music. And I'm going to lower it a little bit so I can speak over it. So, starting here with Domingo, born in 1880 in Jauco, and he passed in 1936. You notice that his wife here is Juana Dominga, shown with my auntie Bibi and my mom, Dorotea, in about 1933, that they died in the same year. She died and he died of a broken heart. He was not sick. He died just a couple months after she passed. This picture's from the early 30s. This also shows, these people led hard life. They were laborers. You notice in a lot of these pictures, they're not smiling. And you had to be tough. And they fought, they defended themselves. It was like the Wild West out here for their whole experience. You notice his right hand is in a cast, and the family lore is because he had punched somebody out recently, the night before, something had happened in which he had his hand in a cast. This is Blaise Camacho, who you mentioned. You said her name the way that we would in Spanish, but she never pronounced her name that way. As a matter of fact, Blaise did not speak Spanish very well. She was born in Hawaii, as was her mom, and she was a English speaker from the beginning, and of course she understood Spanish. But Blaise, her name was Blaise. Sousa came from her husband, Portuguese man Al Sousa, who helped her in this incredible work that she did, writing this book called, as you'll see it in a moment. But she also was born in Kohala. You mentioned Kohala. And she passed in Albuquerque. Blaise did some wonderful work. This is one of the most important works that she did, the Borinkee in Hawaii, where she documented a lot of this history and listed many of the names of the families who left in 1901 in particular and after. And she was also a co-founder and the first president of the Puerto Rican Heritage Society of Hawaii in Honolulu. This is from her book, and it shows that long journey that they took to New Orleans, and then the train to San Antonio, the stop in Los Angeles, San Francisco, Honolulu, 6,500 miles, and two-thirds of that by sea. And this little dedication she put here also lays out why, it reminds us why people immigrate. It's not a vacation. They do it to try to better the lives for themselves and for their families. This is a reminder that the Club Puerto Ricano in San Francisco, it's the oldest, not only the oldest Puerto Rican social club in this country, it's the oldest Latinx organization in the U.S., founded in 1912. And that still exists today, and all of us who are Puerto Rican in the area have an intimate relationship with that place, because we've been in and out of there for all types of events since we were kids. This is a related organization called PRUMA, the Puerto Rican Union of Mutual Aid, founded in 1937 in Union City, still exists, and that's also an enclave of Hawaiian Puerto Ricans. It should be understood that both in the case of the Club Puerto Ricano, which was formed in 1912, and this one, 1937, PRUMA, they were formed by Puerto Ricans who were either on their way to Hawaii or had come back from Hawaii. Hawaiian, that connection is very important in the formulation of both of those organizations. This is my grandma, Elizabeth Perry, as a school student in 1922 in Kauai. And over here is my aunt, her older sister, my aunt Tina. again with my mom and my aunt, Bibi. This is actually my mom's aunt, my grandma's older sister. She's a very important person in our history because, you know, our family came in 1906 from Hawaii, and they arrived with my great-grandma Juana Dominga pregnant with my aunt Tina. They arrived and the city was on fire because of the big earthquake that had just happened. So they had to wait a few months until the baby was born, until my aunt Tina was born, and then had to go back to Hawaii because there was nothing around here for them. Everything was devastated. But Aunt Tina is important because she was a hula dancer. Here she is in around 1930. Here she is again with my mom around that time in San Francisco. She was a professional hula dancer and danced on these cruise ships that would go to Europe or Latin America or to the Far East. This is a cool picture. I really love this picture, and I came across it recently, not too long ago. It's called the Ruiz Rumbadors is the name of this band. This is a band in Hawaii, and I was shocked when I saw this photo for the first time as part of this DVD that's mentioned here at the bottom. Nuestro Cuatro, Volume 1, 2007 production by this incredible organization called the Cuatro Project. The Cuatro Project, they have a website. If you go to that website, it's mentioned there. It's an incredible, incredible research they've done around Puerto Rican culture, music, identity, and the Cuatro in particular. But I was shocked because this gentleman on the right is my grandfather, and I didn't even know he was in a band like that in Hawaii. Now, he's not my blood grandfather, Fidel Cortez, but he got married to my grandmother the year I was born. He's the grandfather that I knew the most through all my years, and he was a musician also. So it was interesting to see him show up in that photo. Here he is, here they are, around the time they got married in 1955. And again, it shows the kind of characters that these Boricuas were. These are two descendants of Puerto Ricans, both born in Hawaii. And my grandma, you could see that she was tough too. She was, you know, she was giving him that look that you just know that he's in trouble. But he's a character, and he was a merchant marine, and they were hard workers. I'm gonna stop the music for a moment here because I want to switch you up to a piece of music that some of you will remember. The people who are a little bit, you know, elders will remember this music. Let me stick this on, see if you could hear this. I'm gonna bump it up for a second. This is Quiet Village. It was a hit in 1959 with Martin Denny. And the person doing all those bird and monkey and sounds of local animals is none other than the Puerto Rican August Colon, shown here. And August is a cousin of ours. August was a Boricua born in Hawaii, and he never went to Puerto Rico. And that was actually common with a lot of these Puerto Ricans. They never went back. Hawaii was his home. And here he is back in that time, around 1959, with Martin Denny. Oh, gosh, I thought the music was going to continue. I'm sorry. This is my uncle, Mingo, who was a son of Domingo Perry. It's my grandma's my grandma's brother, younger brother. He's a great musician, played jazz, a lot of Hawaiian music, Puerto Rican music. Here he is playing in 1960 in the home I grew up in on Bernal Heights in San Francisco, along with Eddie Duarte. But Mingo was kind of the patriarch after his dad passed in the mid-30s. Here's that same event. And this is typical too. This is a party, a baptism for a person that my parents baptized in 1960. This is my brother Frank, who's back is to us, Sal Zorro. This guy back here was also my grandfather. This is Julio Rivera. He was born in Santurce, Puerto Rico. He was married to my grandma Lisa before Fidel, but here's Fidel. So they were all together because my uncle Steve was the son of Julio Rivera, who was a great musician, a great guitarist. And this is Blachi, another cuatrista from Puerto Rico, a Puerto Rican New Yorker who had come out here and was married to my Aunt Bibi. So here's my grandpa Fidel playing Guido, my grandpa Julio Rivera playing guitar in our house where we grew up. And you notice for the party, what's the theme? Hawaii. Everybody's wearing Hawaiian shirts. They have palm fronds laid out all over the place. And it's like that. Here's another great, very close friend of our family, very important in this music from Hawaii among the Boricuas, John Ogao. John Ogao was very close to our family. He was a great musician, an instrument maker. You see the instruments he's using, he made them. It's incredible, incredible. I want to play you now some music that he wrote. He was part of that first trip of the Boricuas Hawaianos that went, that organization that my cousin Blaise helped to form in 1985. When she wrote that book, they organized the first contingent of the return to Puerto Rico of those descendants, and he was among them. And when he went there in 1985, and his experience there was so incredible that he wrote these songs, Aloha Puerto Rico, Tenemos Sangre Borincana. And later he wrote this other tune, Lelolai in Hawaii. But he was very aware and had that present in his music. I want to play you a little bit of that. He's playing all the instruments here that he made. He's playing everything. He's singing, he's playing the bass, the guitar, the cuatro, the huicharo, everything. John Ogao. Here he is. This is the 45 that you're listening to, and it's dedicated to my grandparents, to Fidel and Lisa, that he had signed it to them. Done in 1985. Again, there's the same thing. Now, this is the trip in 1989. I was part of this trip, and this is what kind of want to kind of conclude with this little sequence. In 1989, I went to Puerto Rico with my mom and my grandma to be with my sister, who was living in Bayamón, Puerto Rico at that time. She was getting ready to give birth. It was in January of 1989. And we happened by coincidence to coincide with the Boricuas Hawaianos who were coming to visit Puerto Rico at that time. So this, what you're looking at, is a presentation by those Boricua Hawaianos at the Instituto de Cultura, my mom and grandma and myself and my pregnant sister, very pregnant, were sitting in the audience for this. This gentleman, oh, and all I know about him is Mr. Ayala, was a childhood friend of my grandma's in Hawaii, and they reunited on this trip. They got to know each other and hang out. It was so cute. But the main thing about this trip was that on the airplane to Puerto Rico, I discovered that this was my grandma's first time going to Puerto Rico. She had never been there. Every single year, she returned to Hawaii, to her people in Hawaii, but she had never gone to Puerto Rico, so this was her only trip there. These next few slides are just from that experience. Young, these are all Boricua Hawaianos who were there for the performance in Puerto Rico at the Instituto. Here they're playing some kachi-kachi music. They did hula. It's a beautiful, beautiful experience. And they played this group when they tore us up when they played En Mi Viejo San Juan, because that was my grandma's favorite song. And you know the words to that. Now that my hair's turning white and I need to see you before I die. And it was like, when they got to that line, there wasn't a dry eye in the house, especially from among us, our family. And then later in 2012, this is the place that Paulina referred to, the plantation village in Waipahu. And here I am with my cousin Lopaka Colon. He's the son of Augie Colon, and he's the greatest percussionist now in Hawaii, and he does all those bird calls and things that his father taught him. The plantation village, of course, features all these immigrants who had come to live in that plantation life in Hawaii. What's not included in this particular shot is the Portuguese flag, the Chinese, but they're all represented there. And these are cane cleaner and some implements that show the kind of tough life that they had, where they cooked. This could be in Dakota. This looks like the same type of implements that we saw later in the houses once they moved to the Bay Area. It's my son at the time in a little where the families lived on these plantations. And lastly, I'm going to close with this shot of my mom and my aunt. We call aunt really a cousin, Choco, Josephine. They were super close since they were children, all the way up until the time that my tia passed away. And always they kept present this Hawaiian connection. They were both born in here in San Francisco area. And they wear leis and flowers and Hawaiian shirts, always been the theme. So I know time is short, so I'm going to stop there. And thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Let me get that music off 1 second.
Hey, that's okay. And, you know, you saw how music was such a big part of John's formation and his childhood. I failed to mention, and you may have already read it in the bio that we posted right at the beginning of the promotion for this event, John is a 7-time Grammy-nominated musician himself in his own right, and you can see the legacy that he embodies and he carries forth, a beautiful, rich legacy of Boricua music making. John also mentioned kachi kachi. Heather mentioned it. It'll come up again. Kachi kachi is a banner term that was used to really kind of group together the way the salsa was in the 70s for Fania and the music that was coming out of that generation. Kachi kachi is kind of a banner term for Puerto Rican derived, Latino, and I, as I've come to understand, sometimes some other, because I've heard some Cuban derived music kind of grouped under there as well. But we'll hear about that in a second. We are now, so if we're thinking about the show, as we're thinking about kind of this transmigration, we've gone from Puerto Rico to New Orleans to the West Coast and John's family, West Coast to Hawaii, back to the West Coast, back to Hawaii, back, right? And so here, now we're going to be moving on to Reverend Dr. Sam Cruz, who's going to be sharing with us. But before he does, I wanna just go back to the show for a second so that you have a sense of how this history continued to play out in the show. Let's see. So in one of the early scenes, I mentioned at the beginning, I study bomba. Bomba is black musical tradition in Puerto Rico. And I chose to represent bomba from the South, specifically bomba from Ponce, because I was introducing a storyline about the character here, dressed in white, who was represented, this person was representing Juan Lugo, who was an agricultural worker he was a young man, really. He went with his mother, went with his family to Hawaii, and was touched. His life was touched by the Pentecostalism that was being birthed at that time when he had just moved to Hawaii. He was born in 1890. He goes to Hawaii. He comes back. You're going to hear more about that in a second. But in terms of what's happening here on the screen, the scene shows Juan Lugo and myself, his sister. I'm a fictitious character in this scene, saying goodbye to their family in this bomba moment. And so we used a song, a traditional song that was composed by Don Rafael Cepeda, Mama Cuídame a Belén. We used the arrangement by another group called Paracumbe, that is a slower version of this and is was arranged to be played kind of with a Southern feel. And so this scene in Bomba has two ways of kind of situating these floor drums. If they're acostado or on the ground, you know that's bomba from the South. So it's a visual cue for those who were witnessing the scene. So I sang the song kind of with the singer here, my friend, Lisette Ortiz. I asked her in representation of my mother, Cuídame a Belén, take care of my daughter. Because in this scene, I was representing all of the Boricuas, the majority of whom left and didn't come back. And so Juan Lugo was one of the rare exceptions of these Boricuas that made the 6,000 mile journey and then made it back. And so you see at the bottom of the screen here, kind of at the tail end of the show, we have those spiritual and physical descendants of Juan Lugo, kind of crossing the stage really quickly, singing a corito with tambourines in hand. And we just sang alabare, alabare, all the way across the stage to represent this impact, this indelible impact that really had worldwide resonance. And so with that kind of build up, I'd like to introduce Reverend Dr. Samuel Cruz, who we'll call Sam today. Thank you, Sam, so much for joining us. You have written a really wonderful book called, let me show it, because I would love everybody to support your work, Masked Africanisms, Puerto Rican Pentecostalism. And so with that, please tell us a little more about Juan Lugo and this, how this migration to Hawaii transformed Puerto Rico in terms of religious practices, which also falls under a cultural footprint. I think you're muted.
Could you hear me now? Thank you for allowing me to be part of this panel. It seems like you all know each other really well, and I'm glad to be joining the family. Let me just say before I begin that I really appreciate, Melanie, that you're including religion in this discussion, because I've always asked myself, how could it be that sociologists, anthropologists, scholars, Latino studies people rarely look into the religious lives of Latinos and Puerto Ricans in this case in particular, when religion is culture? And the majority, I always say atheism doesn't do well in Latin America. So it's a huge part of our culture. And so I want to thank you for having me be a part of this panel. But it was while I was doing research for my dissertation that I discovered that the Pentecostal movement in Puerto Rico had its origins in Hawaii. It's interesting because I at that time I thought about my parents, who in the late 50s, my father had been drafted to the military. So he was in Germany and my mother was living in Fort Greene, Brooklyn. And my father asked her to find a church for the family. So she went out looking for a church and she found a small Pentecostal church in Fort Greene and on Carlton Avenue, Myrtle Avenue, which they always called Miltel Avenue. And I thought it was Miltel till I grew up and found out it was Myrtle Avenue. But anyway, and then I grew up in a Pentecostal church in Sunset Park, Brooklyn. And I had no idea that church in Carlton Avenue and that church in Brooklyn and the hundreds of Pentecostal churches throughout the city of New York could trace their history back to this Puerto Rican man called Juan Lugo, who has been called the apostle of Puerto Rican Pentecostalism. He was an agricultural worker in Puerto Rico and like many who were moving on, migrating for a better life, went to Hawaii with his family to work. And while there, I mean, he suffered. He talks about all the suffering he did with all the other Puerto Ricans there, that it was really not a better life that they were having. It was probably even worse. They were away from their homes. But while there, a group of missionaries who were on their way to China and Japan who were leaving from the Azusa Street Revival in Los Angeles, California, this movement had been started by an African-American named William Seymour, decided to make a stopover at the agricultural and governmental industries in Hawaii and do a evangelistic campaign. And Lugo's mother converted to Pentecostalism at that time. She converted to Pentecostalism at that time. And then she started harassing him to join the movement. And eventually he did. He converts to Pentecostalism in 1912, about there. And he has a desire to go preach at his country, Puerto Rico. So he leaves, in 1913 he leaves, but spends 3 years in California among the Puerto Rican community there, preaching to them. After that, he feels a calling to go to Puerto Rico. On August 1916, he leaves to Puerto Rico. He establishes his first church in Puerto Rico on November 3rd, 1916. Now, for me, as a sociologist, what I find interesting with the work he does and the role he plays is that when he gets to Puerto Rico and he begins his religious work there, he comes across American Protestant denominations that really dislike the work he's doing. In fact, they call him ignorant. They say he's not capable of preaching, that he doesn't have the proper training. And in Puerto Rico, there was what was called the committee agreement. Seven denominations met in New York, seven Protestant denominations met in New York City to plan how they would divide up the island in terms of what church, what denomination would go where. And you could still see that in Puerto Rico, where you'll find the more Baptists in one area, more Methodists in another area, Presbyterians in different areas. And so they plan how to divide the island up without permission of anybody there. But also, they also participated with the invasion in that they were used to so-called Americanize the Puerto Ricans. They have statements in which they said, we're going there to help Americanize and civilize the people of Puerto Rico. So these Protestant denominations went there with their imperialistic and racist attitudes. So they had this committee agreement in which, you know, everybody had their part, but Juan Lugo gets to Puerto Rico and Ponce, they actually offer him money to leave Ponce and go up into the mountains because his type of religious tradition that he was selling, and I don't mean that in a negative way, was having an impact upon the people. People were turning more to that. And part of that is that people were able to relate more to what he was saying. Number one, he understood poverty and oppression because he had come from that in Hawaii. And he always said that the gospel he preached had to address those issues. So he was gaining a lot of people, and your mainline Protestant Christianity was not able to accomplish that. But it's important to me to note that he broke that committee agreement or that agreement that they had done without any permission of the Puerto Rican people. Second, or also important, I think it's important to note, and it's just fascinating to me, this whole conversation, how Puerto Ricans, first of all, have contributed in so many ways throughout the world and in the United States, but that Pentecostalism comes from to Puerto Rico from Hawaii. Juan Lugo does something that had not happened in Puerto Rico throughout the last 400 years. He kind of gives the means of religious production, he puts them in the hands of Puerto Ricans. It's the first time that Puerto Ricans themselves are creating and producing the type of religion they want, besides obviously the Afro and indigenous tradition that have been marginalized and bashed and still are by Christianity. So he takes the form of Christianity and turns over the means of production to the Puerto Ricans. But not only is Lugo instrumental in creating and establishing Pentecostalism in Puerto Rico, he establishes the first Puerto Rican Pentecostal church in Brooklyn, in Fort Greene. In 1928, he establishes the first Latino Pentecostal church, Puerto Rican, in Greenpoint, Brooklyn. And at that time, the Pentecostal church was among the first organizations to be there supporting the new Puerto Rican communities. We didn't have many organizations that could do that. And in fact, Puerto Ricans in those days had to worship in the basements of the Catholic church. So they were considered like second-class citizens. They didn't have Puerto Rican priests, and they couldn't even have their mass in the main sanctuary. They had to have it in the basement. So the contributions of Juan Lugo are really extraordinary for someone who didn't have much. They're literally, whether you agree with the religious tradition or not, but they're literally hundreds, well, in Puerto Rico, is out of control practically. But throughout New York City and the United States, there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of churches that trace back their origins to his work via Hawai’i. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Sam. You know, I loved something that you said in your book that was, and I'm trying to figure out how to change my view here because I've got you pinned, but the way I understood what you were saying as somebody who's really about community, a community experience, is that he was basically involved in like grassroots religion. Like he came from the community and he was working with the community to do exactly what you just said, create their own experience that was defined and carved out in a way that represented them. So thank you so much for that. It's such important work that that you've done in that respect. And again, everyone, this is high level. You can see how each person can just give an entire presentation all by themselves about their area of focus. But these are many different cultural footprints. Again, I'm all about repetition for learning. We've got, you know, a kind of a culinary footprint. We have a linguistic footprint in terms of reshaping, reframing Hawaiian articulations of Puerto Ricanidad in Hawaii. We have musical contributions and religious contributions. So now I'd like to take us to our next speaker. So we're on the island now. We are on the island. We have kind of done that circuit. I read in the comments quickly. I'm just looking. Before I do that, Heather, I just want to let you know, as I was doing Juan Lugo's genealogy, I found that his mother's last name was Caraballo Feliciano. And your great grandfather, four generations before you, his name was Jose Caraballo Feliciano. Juan Lugo's family was from Jauco. Your family was from Jauco. I almost had a heart attack thinking, like, is Juan Lugo's like Heather's great, great lost uncle? I don't know yet. I'm on the search, but minimally, his two last names are the same as the two last names of your ancestor. So I thought that was pretty cool. I wanted to share that with everybody. I love those genealogical finds. Thank you, Sam, for that presentation. So we're on the island. We're on the island, and I want to move forward a little bit. And I kind of want to jump back to something that John introduced us to, was this experience of these Boricuas who are self-identifying not as Borinque, but as Boricua Hawaiiano, and this kind of return experience to the ancestral homeland. And with us today is historian Felix Cruz Jusino, who is here to share with us about his experience. Not only is he a historian, but he was actually part of that contingent in welcoming and greeting and guiding this group and their experience. So, Don Felix, if you would, please share with us.
Hi, it is a pleasure to be part of this amazing presentation. It is amazing because for Puerto Ricans, the history of Hawaiian Puerto Ricans are basically unknown. It's something that Blaise and the group of other Puerto Ricans began in the 1960s. Sadly to say, we're, as everybody knows, we're a colony of the United States, and the history that we learn is basically the history they want us to know and to learn about it. But it is interesting that, and there is a couple of things that I want to mention before I got into my relationship with Blaise Camacho Sosa, back in the 1980s, is that you have to understand that Puerto Rico, or the land that we call Puerto Rico, was not called Puerto Rico really until the 20th century. Before, as a matter of identity, we identify the island as Borinquen. And basically, when Puerto Ricans migrated to Hawaii, or they were forced to migrate to Hawaii, whatever you want to, the term that you want to use, they know the island as Borinquen. It was our identity. And we know ourselves in the 19th century as Boricuas or Borinquanos. That's the term that derived into Borinquen. Those Boricuas that migrated to Hawaii in the beginning of the 20th century in 1900, has no knowledge of the English language, didn't know how to write or to read. When they got into the ship in Wanica that took them to Louisiana, they had no idea of what they were going to find when they arrived to Louisiana. They believed, they trusted the people that told them that they would get a better salary, better conditions of life, and that they trusted Americans and believed that Americans were honest people. Sadly to say, their experience was to the contrary. They lied to them, they were mistreated, and they had an horrible life when they arrived to Hawaii. But the most important thing is that this Puerto Ricans that migrated to Hawaii had a sense of belonging to the island that transcended the migration and was kept by their descendants and is still alive in Hawaii. As a matter of fact, 8.9 of Hawaiian population has the roots and those migrants of the 1900s. I have to say that I had the pleasure of meeting Blaise Camacho Sosa by the meet 1980s when she came to Puerto Rico to let the Puerto Ricans know that those Puerto Ricans in Hawaii that migrated in the 1900s still being Puerto Ricans. Her first trip to Puerto Rico was in 1967, and it was part of a discovery, of a research of discovering her Puerto Rican roots. Back in those times, the only people that have worked the migration to Puerto Ricans in Hawaii was Dr. Arturo Morales Carrion and Carmelo Rosario Natal. And basically, most Puerto Ricans were unaware of that event in Puerto Rican history. Blaise took upon herself to investigate that migration and to publish a book to let not only Puerto Ricans in Hawaii know about their heritage, but Puerto Ricans in the island, about their brothers and sisters that live in Hawaii. November 22nd, 1900, 114 Puerto Ricans left the island to Nueva Orleans, or to New Orleans. Of those, only 66 made it to Hawaii. What happened was that during the trip and train to San Francisco, few of them left the train and established themselves from New Orleans to San Francisco, but most of them abandoned the train in San Francisco and established the first Puerto Ricans community in San Francisco. What Blaise wanted to do when she came to Puerto Rico was to create conscience of how important is the Puerto Rican culture and how important is to keep our culture and to fight for our rights to preserve our identity and our heritage for new generations. They were living proof that it doesn't matter how many years pass and how Americanized we can become, but our identity is so strong that will survive any kind of influence, doesn't matter where it comes from. The first thing that happened to our last names were they were Portuguese or Anglicized by the Americans in Hawaii. It was easier for them to pronounce. Second of all, they did was to take away our language and impose English among our children. But it was very difficult for them to do that because language was kept at home and they taught their children about their music, their heritage, the culture, their poetry. And even though by the second or third generations, language was forgotten, they still write songs and poetry in Spanish, even though they didn't know how to sing it or write it. It became part of their heritage and is still part of the Puerto Rican heritage in Hawaii. Blaise was an amazing woman. I had the pleasure of sharing a lot of time with her and with Marion Keith. Listen to her stories, the stories about her family, the stories about Puerto Ricans in Hawaii, and how important it was for them to Puerto Ricans down the island to acknowledge that they were Puerto Ricans. And they are Puerto Ricans. They're basically more Puerto Ricans than any Puerto Ricans that I know. Because Puerto Rican or Puerto Ricanidad is not to be born in Puerto Rico. It's to identify themselves with our heritage, our culture, to identify ourselves to who we are as a sense of people. It's not speaking Spanish. It's not having a Puerto Rican flag. It's to accept as a fact that we are part of a major group of our nation that we call Puerto Rico, or Borinquen. Something that I want to mention here is that I heard about gandules and gandures, and the pronunciation is right either way. It depends where in the island are you from. Most of the Puerto Ricans that migrated from Hawaii were from the southwestern part of the island, from Aguadilla to Ponce. And in that area, if you are from Yauco, Lajas, and San Germán, you pronounce gandules. If you are from Aguadilla and San Sebastián, you pronounce gandures. It depends where in the country you are from. But the reality is that it doesn't matter how you say gandules or gandures, it is our being. It's our part of who we are. Arroz con gandules is a sense of identity. It represents us. I heard the amazing presentation about the yams, and it is interesting that most of our children today don't eat yams, don't eat batata, and they prefer to eat McDonald's, and that is part of the Americanization that we are still on constantly. Also love the presentation of Sam talking about religion and the division the American churches did of Puerto Rico. And it's still going on because you have Presbyterian and Adventists in the Western part, you have Episcopalians in the Northern part, etc. But the reality is that those churches are no longer American churches, they are Puerto Rican churches because we have been able to Puerto Ricanize all those churches. They are Puerto Ricans now. And the most important thing is, doesn't matter where you live, you have to be proud of your heritage and make sure that everybody knows that your roots are Puerto Ricans. It doesn't matter if you are seventh generation of Puerto Ricans born in Hawaii or in the United States. Blaise was conscious of that, and her legacy is that she revived a very important part of our history, make everybody aware of how important it was for everybody knows and acknowledges the Puerto Ricans in Hawaii. But at the same time, know it or not, she was creating sense that there is only one Puerto Rican nation, and that Puerto Rican nation you can find it in Puerto Rico or in anybody else in the world. We have to honor Blaise's memory as we have to honor the memories of all those families that migrated to Hawaii in the beginning of the 1900s. And built a sense of country, of Puerto Rican country, that our kachi is the only, the last of that migration to Hawaii. Now we have Cocuyes in Puerto Rico and Cocuyes in Hawaii. And there's a sense that the Hawaiian islands are part of Puerto Rican and part of our history.
So true. Thank you, Dr. Cruz Jusino. You provide such a wonderful and rich kind of recap of this experience of this migration. Again, I would love to continue to have this conversation with each one of you, and I know many of you would love to continue to hear from these. So please invite our guests to your institutions, to your communities, reach out to them, engage them, so that we can continue telling this story and making sure that it's heard and that we're bringing light to this history. Gracias, Dr. Cruz Jusino.
Thank you.
I want to be mindful of our time. I kind of set aside 2 hours for us, thinking maybe we could get through in an hour and a half. So we're already very close to the end. We've had questions. I apologize. I forget with the screen share. You can see I'm looking. I'm trying to keep track of all the questions everywhere if I can. I do, now that we've kind of covered that transmigration, I do want to go to the show now and kind of wrap it up with the show. And so we've reviewed all of these different cultural footprints. There are many others. Dr. Cruz Jusino, Don Felix, he mentioned that some people got off the train. I've actually been working with one family that has just always considered themselves African-American, but recently saw that on one of the birth certificates, they have a birth certificate that identifies a woman, and a female ancestor from about this period of time in Southern Texas. So I'm working with that family to try to determine if that ancestor was part of this migration and kind of hopped off the train and settled in that area. So I'm working on that. Maybe when we revisit this panel, we have an anniversary of the panel in the future, I can provide some more information. I want to move on now to a longtime friend of mine, Keito St. James, who is a Kumuhula, which I had to look that up, even though I've known him for a long time, means hula master, dancer. He's also a kachi choreographer. Keito actually provided two choreographies that I performed in the show. One was a hula to Pua Olena, and then Kachi Kachi, a song by the same title. Keito, I'd like to introduce you now and ask if you have been dancing your whole life. And I would love for you to, first, I'm gonna need you to unmute yourself so that we can all hear you. And then I would love for folks to just hear your experience. Oh, I think we took off the camera, but there we go, we're back. I would love for everybody to just hear. Tell us a little bit about Kachi Kachi. What has been your experience? What else can you tell us that we don't know about Kachi Kachi? You've lived this.
Aloha kawa to everybody, and mucho gracias. I tell you, it's fantastic, people that I'm listening to today. This is a great history of the Puerto Rican culture and the Borinque culture. My experience is in the island of Hawaii. I'm a kumuhula, which means that I teach the Hawaiian culture. And a lot of us on the island are, like some people did say, we're a mix, a chop suey of many different cultures, the blend of, to make the Hawaiian islands. And I really didn't know much about my Borinque culture other than that, you know, the history was there. My family enjoyed bomba and playing on the beaches. Even this summer, my cousins are dancing just drums on the beach, you know? And it was really a pleasure to meet Melanie over 20 years ago and to be able to share in her history. Really, her vision of knowing more about these people from Hawaii, the Borinques from Hawaii, that I didn't know anybody even cared about. So it was really, really interesting. Our hula halau, one of the things that we did with our family is we always had a kachi kachi section in our show. And so we were able to bring it to Chicago and actually perform some of the dances that my family did back home in the islands and to share it. And I realized that I'm like one of the very few halaus or even groups that even dance kachi kachi, other than the great music that comes from the Bay Area. And it was very, very enjoyable. But it's really important, I do see, that we do preserve these special cultures so that they can be passed on. And I'm really glad to be proud of that, for sure. I don't have a big syllabus for you today.
No, that's actually, I think it's just your necessary voice, your critical voice. The fact that you can just tell us that you're one of the few groups that provides a kachi kachi choreography in the continental United States makes your voice important. You're representing 100 years of Borinkee tradition in the continental United States. And so I'm grateful for that and grateful for your participation, longtime friend, and thank you. Thank you for being part of that. Let's see. I want to go back for a second. Keito, is there anything else you want to share with us about the show, about that participation, those choreographies?
Yeah, a lot of our dances were, like I said, you know, I think it's more akin to, I guess, people, what they call plena. And the reason why I know that now is because I had a chance to go to Hawaii about 8 years ago, and with the Institute of Puerto Rican Cultures, and to see bomba and to see plena.
You went to Puerto Rico, right? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Went back to Puerto Rico. And to see what we were doing back home in Hawaii and see what was happening in Puerto Rico. And I even got a chance to see the bate, which was really fascinating. And people could see the Taino in my face or the island in my face. It was really interesting to talk to everybody. But that was really great because when I brought back the knowledge in Puerto Rico, I could actually see what the motions we were doing and how they fit into the Puerto Rican culture. So it was really nice.
Thank you for that. So we, Borinkee, this concept of Borinkee, this identity that kind of is very stigmatized still in Hawaii, was a real driver for the show. So I shared with my friend, Chris Carroll, who I've introduced and who's a director. She's gonna help close out our panel now before we skip to some of the questions. I will say that if any of the panelists have to go at 4 o'clock, I just to be respectful of their time, I'm sorry if any of them have to and we won't be able to get to a question to them, but I do want to kind of, if you can stay, I would love for you to stay. This concept of Borinkee became a driver for the show. And I shared with Chris, I said, my vision for the end of the show, now that we've done this transmigration, is to go back to Hawaii at the end, in the final scene. I too sang that in Mi Viejo San Juan, as the ballad, as I wrote on Facebook, kind of the ballad of the diaspora that doesn't actually get to go back to the island, to Puerto Rico. And has that longing and nostalgia about that separation. But the final scene actually was driven by this idea of, I want to represent kind of these nameless, faceless Borinkees, these Boricua Hawaiiano who we know about, we know of, but we don't know personally. And the history has overlooked, I wouldn't even say erased, I just think they've been overlooked. And so I shared this vision. I said, Chris, I want to do this scene where we close the show and there's just a crowd. Everybody who came out to support me, I just want them to kind of stand around me and maybe like a spotlight on me, but just stand around me in the dark so that we see a crowd of people, a crowd of Borinkees. And so he actually surprised me and came to me and said, I designed this shirt. I think they should wear this shirt too. And so, as I told you at the beginning, the koki was an important part of opening the show and closing the show in terms of this metaphor of when the koki leaves Puerto Rico, does it actually die? No, it doesn't. it just adapts, assimilates, and just like the Puerto Ricanos who left Puerto Rico, left the Caribbean, and went to Hawaii, it was tough. Getting there was tough. In every sense of the word, staying there was tough. Never being able to go back home for so many of them was tough. And so, but they did, they survived, they made it, they pushed through, they overcame those circumstances. And so she came to me with this t-shirt, she printed them in tropical colors. We had this hot pink, we had yellow, and we had a blue. And so you can see, here's a picture of some of those folks who came out to help. And I'm wearing this pink one that's in the background here. And this is how we close the show. Just honoring those ancestors who made that treacherous and perilous journey and survived and planted roots and created a new diaspora, a new portion of the diaspora in the Pacific. So we close the show by honoring them. And now I would like to introduce Cristin Carole. She has so many titles. I kept trying to pick one that would fit, and none of them fit because she's just amazing and incredible. Here she's listed as an arts integration specialist because it's one of the many, many things she does. She's a modern ballerina. She's an ethnographer. She does so much. And I'm so honored to call her one of my best friends for a long time, since undergrad, 25 plus years ago. So with that, Chris, you are invited. Please tell us what it was like. I'm going to ask you to unmute. Tell us what it was like to take somebody else's vision and somebody else's research and somebody else's ideas and help kind of curate that so that it could be something that made a statement and tell this particular story.
Wow. Well, thank you, Melanie, so much. I'm ready to do this show all over again, however many years it's been later, because of this incredible research team you've assembled to inform the work. Melanie has always been a touchstone around culture and identity for me. I met her in college. I'm a Black woman. My parents are Black on both sides. I'm a Black girl from the South Side of Chicago. But the way I appear means that throughout my childhood, throughout my upbringing in Chicago, I was taken as a Puerto Ricana, right? Is it pretty good there? I'm getting on my pronunciation. And in meeting Melanie in college, one of the things that she introduced me to was her really open acceptance of her African identity and the Africanisms that were really embedded and inherited in Puerto Rican culture. And so that put me on a journey in my own adult life, growing up very kind of bourgeois, light-skinned Black in Chicago, and saying, what are my indigenous gifts and skills, right? What is my culture about? And so for this show, coming from the outside in, but also having known Melanie for such a long time, it was about, in a way, being open to realizing her vision, but also to the process. And I think in hearing this and seeing how much research and how much narrative was included in that story, you know, as artists, we often, I see this beautiful painting behind Miguel, you know, the product is what goes on the wall, but we know, right, as artists, that the process is where the work happens, right? The process is where the growth takes place. And so this work was about acculturation, it was about assimilation, it was about multiple identities, and I'm sitting here in my space right now doing all of this work around courageous conversations about race, and that Borinkee, that negative connotation is really the negative connotation around the Blackness, right? The Africanism of the island that they brought with them, that texture of hair, that African music, that African rhythm, that African dance that we see in our society now is something we need to be able to talk about and recognize and discuss. Listening today, hearing about the consumerism and how that was really the driving that American industrial consumer machine really drove the displacement of these people. Okay, I'm ready to do the show again, Melanie. It's been a fantastic and just a fantastic thing. I will share one tantalizing piece that came up for me, and then I do have another appointment today. I think I can share my screen. And this came out of something that I learned from doing this work with Melanie that led to a work that I did later with the Court Theater in Chicago. This is a scene from Porgy and Bess. I did it at the Court Theater in Chicago. And when I was doing the reading and research, not familiar really with that opera, what I recognized from my own ancestral and cultural experience in the Bahamas was the Pentecostal traditions and roots, but also the West Africanism that was in the practice, that was in Port Gambes, the Sea Island culture, the island culture. And so in thinking about this work that I did out of what Melanie had really taught me around understanding the full context of doing an artistic work, you have to do your research, you have to know your history. The actors have to know it too. And so in my work for this production, we toured Pentecostal churches. I toured them, found one that I thought was really closest to what Melanie and I discussed around the Pentecostal practice in the islands. And those actors went there because how could I expect them, right, as a dance tradition, as dancers, as performers, to catch the Holy Ghost night after night with any sort of authenticity without understanding the process of the people. So I just want to really recognize Melanie Maldonado in a kind of a genius way of art and people, art and culture, art and our identity, that in order to make really high quality production, that's the responsibility, right, of the artist, is to dig and to understand and to project and share and represent through their own filter, through their own sieve. So that's my share. I'm so excited. I'm trembling. I'm so excited. What an amazing collection of people today, what an incredible amount of sharing, and I'm eager to hear the questions. I will stay on as long as I can, but my meeting just started now. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Chris. You're forever part of the identity of this show, so whether you want to or not, you're part of the next incarnation of it. Well, this is a time to take questions. I've been trying to kind of keep an eye on the chat. I guess let me take off a few so you don't see me scrolling through the chat. There's so much material. My head is spinning right now. I want to get to like all the questions. I know there was a question early on about did Puerto Ricans stay in Hawaii? As I said, I think I've seen some evidence that there were Puerto Ricanos who kind of escaped, and Don Felix kind of alluded to that, not just in San Francisco, but in some other places, certainly not to the degree that they did in San Francisco, but there was some other escapism. Let me see. I want to get to some of these questions. I know some of the panelists have been active, so thank you for that. Let's see. Is there a question that one of the panelists saw that they would like to answer while I'm scrolling through?
Yes, I have a question. Please. And it is about the Pentecostalism, because I'm considering, like, what about that sort of, when I was doing my research in the Bahamas, I felt that they were discovering their relationship with the Gullah people. They didn't know that they were doing counterclockwise circles. They didn't know that that was related to the West African slaves that had been brought. So I would love to ask the panelists what they find to be the relationship between the Pentecostal practice in Puerto Rico and maybe indigenous African religion, or how, just, I would love to hear about that.
And I would love for Sam to take that question on, and any other panelists would like to chime in.
You're on mute, Sam.
Yeah, you're muted.
What I've discovered, or what I argue in this book I wrote many years ago, is that there's an affinity between some of the African religious traditions in the Americas and Pentecostalism, and that people. I argue it's not the only reason, but I argue that a lot of Caribbean people are attracted to it because, I mean, you could still, there's always the pressure of being Christian in Puerto Rico and in the United States. So you could say you're Christian and still be doing really what you want to be doing, which is being possessed by spirits, divination, and all the other things that are very compatible to the African-based traditions. In fact, this is not an advertisement, but On the 29th, I'm on a panel that Dr. Marta Moreno Vega and I put together with looking at like 7 or 8 of the African-based traditions and the similarities with Pentecostalism, and also just looking at the dialogue as what has happened, you know. But there is, spirit possession especially, there are people who have traced different types of spirit possessions to Africa, because there were spirit possessions in Europe, but a lot of what happens, even in the Black Baptist Church, people have written about how Africanisms have survived within that tradition. So I think a lot of the stuff that happens in a Pentecostal church is misunderstood. In fact, Latino scholars sometimes ridicule what happens in Pentecostal churches while uplifting culture in a folkloric way. When it's historical, it's okay. So you could talk about the African traditions, but then when you see it happening in Brooklyn on a storefront church, you think it's a funny thing when people are being possessed. Do you get what I mean? That it's there, but it's acceptable for scholars or even people who are very proud of their culture when it's historical. When it's still alive, it's not. So I think a lot of Africanisms and just African culture is being manifested in these churches.
As a matter of fact, I would like to add to that, that one of the reasons why Pentecostalism in Puerto Rico, it has found its niche, is because that relationship to Africanism and our tradition of possession, of spiritual possessions. It was a way of saying, I'm Christian, but I can perform, I can believe in my old gods, and I'm still acting like crazy and wild and being accepted as a Christian and as a member of a society, more than being rejected because you believe in other gods.
You know, Marta Moreno Vega has done a lot of ethnographic work in Piñones, Luis Aldea. And she discovered that 1 year she went and was meeting with Espiritistas, she came back 2 years after and they were Pentecostal. But they were doing the exact same thing. It hadn't really changed much, except gave them some cultural capital, I guess, to some extent. Because the African-based traditions are really maligned in our society.
I'm going through they're such wonderful conversation. I want to mention two things. One, Borinkee, yes, in some families, in some communities, Borinkee is kind of reappropriated to be an endearing term, but it still has that a little bit of that stigma in the archipelago, in the islands. This show was trying to make a statement of reappropriation of that history in part. Several people mentioned kachi, and I know I said I did want to go back to that. If you followed me, you know, one, I try to create opportunity for engagement at all levels. So even if you can't go to Puerto Rico and be part of my Biennial Bomba Research Conference, if you have been watching all my posts, you will have learned a lot, because I share a lot of information, just as they did in anticipation of this. Even if folks couldn't get on the call with us today, they would have learned. And we actually, if you paid attention to the post, they actually followed the show and followed this transmigration, because I want people to learn. It's important to me that they learn. And so I saw a question about kachi choreography, like that exists. It's like anything that moves from a space of practice, of community engagement to spectacle. It has to be commodified. It has to be kind of boxed so that it's presentable. And so that in that way, kachi choreography for the stage, presenting the kind of a banner tradition, really can be any one of the musics that fall under this kachi. So let me start here. So from this book, I read a story a long time ago by author Rodney Morales, and I posted an excerpt from it. where he actually introduces us to the idea of, in his short story, Ship of Dreams, about kachi kachi and the melding of different communities in Hawaii. In his story, there's a gourd that goes missing at a Japanese like produce business, and the young boy of the Japanese family is in love with the daughter of one of the Puerto Rican families. He kind of seeks her out on the weekends and kind of wanders toward the music that's playing by the Puerto Rican families. And they hear a familiar sound in the story, and I retold the story as an adaptation. And so they hear this. And so that's the guicharo, that's the Taino word in Puerto Rico, guicharo, for the gourd, the hollow dried gourd that becomes a scraper instrument. And so in Puerto Rico, in the Hawaiian Islands, when non-Puerto Ricans hear this, all they don't know what to call it. They don't know it's called a guicharo, as John even mentioned guicharo earlier. All they know is they hear the sound. And so that sticks. And so that kachi kachi becomes the term for Puerto Rican music kind of at large, all expressions of Puerto Rican music. And so in 1985 also, it was a pretty significant year for Puerto Rican history in Hawaii and the documentation of it and the experience and these connections. There's a researcher that goes to Hawaii. He goes to different everyday places and just records, documents. And those, and that information is made available in this 1989 release by Smithsonian Folkways, that kind of the broad title is Puerto Rican Music in Hawaii, and the subtitle is Kachi Kachi. So everything on here is considered Kachi Kachi. And and what do we have on here? We have plena. John started out by playing a plena. We have seis con décima. We have some like church music. We have a danza. All of that falls under the banner of kachi kachi. So if it's a danza choreography, it's a kachi kachi choreography inherently. So I hope that answered some of those questions. Chris, thank you. I know you have to
Melanie,
go. Thank you so much.
Melanie, let me add to that about kachi kachi. Kachi kachi really is what we call the seis in Puerto Rico. It's the traditional country music of all the hillbillies, or the music of the jíbaro, the music of the mountains, which is the music that used el güiro, el guicharo, the gourd, as part of the instrument. It was our jíbaros transformed the drum of the coast into the sound of the cuatro. When you do a study of the Puerto Rican music, you will find the African roots of our music in every single of the different type of music that we perform. And kachi kachi is basically that. It's the original seises that were played in the the end of the 1900s and the beginning of the 20th century. And it was taken to Hawaii and has an evolution to that music as the influence of all the Puerto Ricans' migration. But we talk about the migration of 1901 to 1902, but we forgot about the migration of 1920 that also happened. And later on, we had other migrations in the 1940s, and as late as in the 1990s, we have Puerto Ricans. As all those migration of Puerto Ricans inherited with the other Puerto Ricans, the original Puerto Ricans that migrated at the beginning of the 20th century, they have added to that kachi kachi music the different rhythm of the Puerto Rican music. And we have to bear in mind that when we talk about kachi kachi, we have to go back to the seises of the jíbaros music, and to that add the different sounds of the Puerto Rican pantagram.
And I thank you for bringing that up, because I want to keep circling back to this idea. There was an Afro-Indigenous primarily group of traditions that went to Puerto Rico. I mean, that went from Puerto Rico to Hawaii. It was this, it was that Black Taino amalgamation of experiences that went to Hawaii. It's you hear it in Heather's story about her grandmother saying so-and-so had Borinkee hair. And so we see this kind of played out. And to Miguel, I don't think he had a chance to speak of it because of the short time available. But I know that in his own research, Miguel, if you want to take a moment and just talk about how, you know, with these kind of new arrivals and the food, the produce, the items that they brought with them, how maybe they even became represented in some of these crate labels, how you, that kind of those nods to the Boricuas are evidenced in these crate labels.
Sure. I mean, from the beginning, so as visual sort of documents, right? I think of them as kind of visual documents, right? And if you look at race and representation of Puerto Ricans in the United States, it's not a coincidence that Puerto Ricans were imagined visually as Black people from the South. Even if those images were offensive and stereotypical kinds of caricatures, it's because Puerto Ricans are Black, and that migration, you know, was also about Black Puerto Ricans, that those images exist, right? And I think that's an important part of that the story for me, is sort of reclaiming that history in a way that actually embraces Blackness as an aspect of our history and heritage also, right? Because it has been so repressed, and because of the racism within the experience of colonialism especially, right? There, it has been repressed in Puerto Rico, and it's been repressed in the US. And so when I started making those paintings, it was really about also just kind of recovering some of that history, doing the research. Even the sugar corporations based in California, we were looking for new laborers, imagined Puerto Ricans somehow as a wider kind of labor group of people. And I thought that was really revealing. And they were surprised that that's not who arrived in many cases. And so that's not just true of Puerto Rico, but also, I mean, of Hawaii, but also like in the Arizona migration, there was a migration of cotton workers to go to Arizona in the 20s. And some of the same politics, racial politics, are applied to Puerto Ricans at that time too. And they're not sure sort of how to classify Puerto Ricans, right? Who are Black and who are mixed race and, you know, in between in some spaces. But I think it brings up a really important issue that for me is, I thought about it a lot with the Borinkee and the sort of like idea of something that is stigmatized and then later embraced by a generation. Is very much like La Mancha de Plátano, right? It reminds me of that expression, right? And La Mancha de Plátano is something that was originally used as a kind of stigmatizing term, right? Associating, you know, the literal mancha of the plantain, the stain of the plantain, right? Which stains your skin brown or your clothing brown or whatever that it touches, as a kind of stain upon an imagined white skin, perhaps, right? And so the racism, even within that terminology, it runs deep. And so, and it later flips for another generation, especially for New Yorkans, for example, right? So La Mancha de Plátano is the indelible mark of my Puerto Ricanness, right? That will never go away. And it's embraced with a lot of pride. And Blackness as part of Puerto Ricanness has been heavily embraced also by New Yorkans in a special way. And I think that's part of, you know, part of that is about the shared experiences between Black and Puerto Rican communities in New York and in other parts of the states. But one of the currents that I thought about a lot today was about the way in which the conditions of our migration have encouraged a kind of anglicizing, a kind of repression, a kind of whitening of our experience in order to blend in those that could, right? Blend in or sort of have agency and access in different spaces, right? Which is not unique to Puerto Ricans necessarily, but that has been part of our experience in the US makes me think of what the stakes of that experience are today on the island, right? Because these are issues that haven't gone away, right? They're constantly in negotiation. And the way that, you know, Puerto Ricans on the island or here sort of imagine the status and the stakes of our future in relation to the US and who we are, you know, brings up these fundamental questions for me about what is the role of white supremacy, right, in colonialism, in religion, right, and in our colonial histories? And how do we sort of then, you know, work through these histories in really open and honest ways? And for me, part of the way of doing that is sort of interrogating the visual record and the visual history and kind of turning it inside out and upside down in order to sort of illustrate how white supremacy has been used as a tool to colonize. So that's a lot.
But it's important. It's important to hear. It's important to talk about. And it's important to kind of take away and continue doing the work. Each one of us. I thank you. I want to be cognizant of our time. I know we've gone over. We have Heather. John, did you want to say something on this subject? No? Okay. Heather, there was a question, and I think you're the best person to answer this. Is there an area in Hawaii where the majority of Puerto Ricans currently live?
Yeah, I was looking at that question. I think currently, well, I know that my grandmother on Oahu was Kalihi. It's not that way anymore. I think the Big Island, I think a lot of Puerto Ricans, I think you mentioned that a lot of Puerto Ricans went to Oahu. Everybody I know who's Puerto Rican traces their family back to like Kohala, Hawaii. My family is from Hawaii. And so I know that a lot of people on the Big Island of Hawaii, I think you can see some of the characteristics that they still look a little bit Puerto Rican. In general, we're also mixed. Like you'll see, well, I'm Portuguese, Puerto Rican, Hawaiian, Chinese, Japanese, like that kind of stuff. We'll name all of them. And we're proud of all of them, you know? So I don't think now, there might be. I know when I think of communities that have that are Puerto Rican, I think of the Big Island, but I don't think of them all in one specific area. I know, like I said, when I was younger, actually I think my mom's generation, they would always go to Kalihi. It was Lower Kalihi in the valley, and that's where all the Puerto Ricans were. That's also where the Puerto Rican Association was. But now, I don't know, maybe Keito.
Oh, wait, you're muted.
Did we lose you? Did we lose you? Heather, you were talking?
I'm here.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay. Well, I don't know. I don't know what you heard and what you didn't. I said maybe somebody else might know. I don't know. But for me, it's all kind of like, it's all integrated now. We have spots where you can still get your pateles. And then again, I said like the Big Island, but other than that, I don't know of anywhere.
Hello?
Keito, say something.
Am I back on yet? Yeah. 1 second.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Come on now. Am I on? No.
No. Oops.
Well, Kawhi. Did we lose Keito? You're muted. Keito, if you want, I'm sure you're saying something really interesting. We want to hear you. You're muted.
Oh. I hear.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay, good. My family's from the Big Island, but a lot, like I was telling her, you guys earlier, like we were so blended with so many different nationalities that it's like, oh yeah, my cousin, yeah, she's Hawaiian Puerto Rican or Hawaiian Filipino Puerto Rican. Yeah. And that's, I mean, every kid in school has 5 nationalities. And so, but I can tell you that my cousins who still live in Hawaii, their kids are now the 5 mixes plus Japanese or plus Haole or plus, Filipino. So they're on their 6 and 7 mixes now. And so it's really a blend, but we can see in the faces, like she said, I can be on the bus stop and I can see what I think a Borinkee face looks like and go, oh, you're Puerto Rican, you know? And so you can see that. And also with kachi, there's also the Filipinos and some of the Portuguese who still also like Latin sounding music. And so a lot of the same communities, we all will relate to the kachi sound, you know? And then of course, since the 80s, there's been the big salsa has come to Hawaii, and I see, you know, I go home now and there's so many salsa stations. There's a lot of Spanish-speaking Mexican population, lots of Colombian, Nicaraguans, Brazilians. I mean, Hawaii has changed with all the new Latinx type people. And I still see, you know, sometimes people speaking Spanish. And when I speak Spanish, they go, oh, the Hawaiian can speak our secret language, you know? And it's so funny because the world in the past 20 years, it's changed so much, you know? And so definitely.
We do have a lot of military. And so there are a lot of Puerto Ricans who come from,
you know,
military. So they're there. Yeah, so it's a new generation almost. Yeah, new generation. And then somebody did mention in the chat, Maui. I know Maui has, I think in doing genealogy, going to Maui is, they it's easier to do your genealogy in Maui if you're Puerto Rican or Portuguese because of the associations that they have there.
Well, and I would love for you to, I want to, maybe we could close with this picture. I know there was a question about which islands, but I posted this on Facebook this week, and it's just it's a newspaper clipping that shows the passengers will be landed at various plantations on the different islands. There have been a couple of references. So for those of us who don't know that much about Hawaii, we hear Big Island, we hear Kauai, we hear Kohala. Can you just tell us, Maui, we hear Oahu. Can you just tell us, without the map in front of us, I know some of these terms are all in one place, like the Big Island. So can you just
kind of share? The Big Island is Hawaii, okay. But it's really big. It's bigger than Puerto Rico, and it's almost like 6 hours across from Kona, which is on the dry side of the island. And it takes like 4 hours to drive across to Hilo, and Hilo is the rainy side. And then if you go into Pahoa, your cell phones don't work. You know, it's a volcanic side, and a lot of they always say that if you live in the Pahoa side, you can disappear because it's the jungle and it's uncharted, and so there's so much diversity. We have the snow-capped mountains, we have the black sand beach. The green sand beach, the brown sand beach, you know, we have so much more variety going on the Big Island. And also it has its own culture. So hula in the Big Island is not the same as hula in Maui or hula in Oahu or Kauai. And they'll tell you if they're from Oahu, the Big Island people say, oh, that's not our hula, you know? So I think even the Puerto Rican culture could be different too from your perception of what island you come from. And I remember my aunt was in Kauai. I went to Kauai for 4th of July. And the people in Kauai said, oh yeah, I was in Maui. It was so busy, the traffic. I'm like, Maui, you know? And so people really have a different perception of the world, you know, from different islands. And I try to tell my Caribbean friends too, because, you know, we have a chain of 7 islands, which is like the whole Caribbean archipelago, you know, and each one is all Hawaii, you know.
Well, I'm sorry we can't get to more. I do feel like we probably need to end here. I think we could probably keep talking about all these subjects. There's so many nuances, so many intricacies. Again, I apologize. It was such a high level history. I know there's so much more to drill down in, but I feel like we accomplished the goal, which was to map out the cultural footprint. And there's so many other ways. There are so many other ways we can take a filter this information through or lens that we can use to analyze this history. I would like to just thank all of our panelists. Thank you so much for being part of this really special moment. This special conversation, this history sharing. Thank you to all of you who attended and donated to do so. Thank you so much for helping make this happen and the sharing. I'd like to thank again Alianza Center, which came on as an event sponsor, and then Puerto Ricans in Action, ASHE, which is Cristin Carole's group, which is also the Shirley Hall Dance Educators Forum, Sociedad Puertorriqueña de Genealogía, and Bomba Marile for their promotional support. we have to continue telling these stories. We have to continue studying. We have to continue educating ourselves and one another. So thank you for what you're doing to take now this knowledge and continue growing our awareness of our own histories, our own stories, and the stories of others so that we can share them in a way that respects the ancestors and the contributions made by all. Thank you, everyone. I appreciate it. I apologize we weren't able to get to all the questions. But thank you. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you. Mahalo. Gracias.
Thanks, Melanie.
Sure. Adios.
Y mahalo.
Mahalo.
Thank you, Melanie. Thanks to everybody.
Gracias.